I want to read from a text, and we're kind of post-resurrection, and I want to kind of spin off of the post-resurrection moment, if I can, and I want to go right before the moment Jesus ascends into heaven, which is important, an important moment to me, and it's Acts chapter 1, the 4th and the 5th verse, and it is a challenge. And I just got to be honest, it's not a challenge that I always like, but I think it is a necessary part, because sometimes we can settle for average, sometimes we can settle for good, but God wants to give us great. And getting great often requires patience, and this is something that we're going to see here, that God is going to lay on to his followers as he gets ready. In fact, we're just moments from the ascension. We're just moments from him ascending into the sky, and the angels say, "Why are you looking here, gazing? This same Jesus who you've seen is..." We're just seconds before that. So I kind of contend that it's an important moment. Wouldn't you agree that an important moment is the last moments that you would have with somebody that maybe that was here on earth? If somebody was lying in their deathbed, I'd like to hear their last, you know, moments when they're coherent, when they're being able to reflect. And this moment here, in some ways, is more relevant. All of Jesus's life is relevant. But these are the last words. When he says, when we think it's his last words at the resurrection, that's one thing. They're thinking, oh, that was his last words. No, those weren't his last. This will be his last physical presence and the last word. So Acts chapter 1, beginning with verse 4 and verse 5. I want to read just two portions of scripture after setting that up. Gathering them together, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem. Those people that had been following him the last 40 days from resurrection until this ascension, but to, and here's my key word, wait. For what the Father had promised, which he said, "You have heard of me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." And the word there that I want to draw in on is that word wait. Wait. And let's just get a consensus. How many people in here love to wait? And the church was in unity, which means we can have revival. Because nobody likes to wait. And that is the title of my message after a... God dropped this in my heart. My title is this: 75 seconds. And you're going to wonder, 75 seconds. What does 75 seconds have to do with this? Well, I'll give you this, because it has a lot to do with waiting. 75 seconds is the average amount of time that the light is red. The red light that you dart through way too many times. I hate the red light, catching it. And so when God dropped this into my spirit, and I thought, okay, I'm gonna time this up, because this is average. They say sometimes it's fewer and sometimes it's a longer light. How many think it feels like it's always longer than 75 seconds? Yeah, that's me too. And they say some of them are actually 45 or 50 seconds. I've hit those too, where it just seems like it's there and it turns. Maybe late in the evening they change the sensors or whatever. But 75 seconds is the average. So last night after prayer, I got my stopwatch out and I hit it. And bam, 131st and 37. Perfect. This morning I got up. I thought, I am going to figure out how long do I wait from Noblesville, where we live, all the way to the church house. And would you know it? I didn't hit but one stoplight, and I only got a portion of it. And I waited from our house pulling out of the driveway to this building a total of 28 seconds. It was a good day. Got here extremely early. Normally a 20-minute drive took about 14. But that idea of waiting for that light, and is there anybody that right now would confess that you are a runner of the yellow-red? Woo! We got a great percentage of people that are... How many of you here, if you even sense the scent of yellow, that you're already smashing, no, not hitting the gas? Maybe we should go both ways. How many, when you think the green is getting ready to change yellow, that you go ahead and stop? Oh, there's a few. Unfortunately, one of them is my wife. Drives me crazy. I'm gonna have to wait 75 seconds now. And then once the 75 seconds, once you hit it, how many of you actually pray that you can have more than 75 seconds so you can finish the text or finish looking at the Instagram? And then you get frustrated at the person that takes the extra 5 seconds after you've waited 75, because they're on their phone. And how many are faithful that when it turns green and they're sitting there to smash the horn? Oh, we're getting a lot of things exposed in the spirit here right now. We can have an altar of repentance. And I guess I should ask, how many, when you see the green going yellow and it's going red, hit it as hard as you can go? Oh my goodness, this is even a bigger percentage, which tells me that the general population of Life Connections does not like to wait. But waiting is such a necessary element. And because of people that just raised your hand, you realize that almost 50% of accidents that happen at a red light. It's there that impatience is seen more than it. The probability of you being hit is greater, not on the interstate or some state road, but at a stoplight. Because so many people are impatient. They don't have the ability to say my life or somebody else's life is more valuable than me pressing it through this moment. In fact, the possibility of you dying in an auto accident is higher, not on an interstate where they're doing 75, but at a stoplight or a stop sign where somebody will turn in and you're T-boned, or somebody hits you from behind as you are waiting and they didn't stop. The greatest place of death in your car is supposed to be the place of safety. That red light was created because there was congestion there. There was a problem in there. There was the potential of an accident. There had been accidents, and they said, we need to put something that diverts, something that stops, something that slows people down, and the red light was created to do that too. And that now has become the most dangerous place because of impatience, the inability to wait. It's a wonder that you live in the roundabout county of the world. I think per capita, Hamilton County has more roundabouts than any place in the nation. And what is it a statement of? It's a statement that you all, that you just confessed that you did not like to stop, that it's an acknowledgement by our city officials that people in Fishers don't want to stop. So we will remove the red lights and we will put roundabouts in so that if we can't stop you, at least we can slow you down. And that if you still don't decide to stop, you're going to hit a pine tree or a rock in the middle of one of those things, or a big fancy mural. They're going to put something in there so you don't damage somebody else. You just damage yourself. The roundabout. And they're just created. Those roundabouts are created just to slow us down, to help us wait when we don't have the ability to. And I wonder how many times God has to put roundabouts in our lives. Because we have decided that we can't stop, we won't stop, we don't have time for a church, we don't have time for devotion, we don't have time for prayer. And God said, okay, you don't have time, since you don't want to stop, since you don't want to take time to interject me into your life, to ask me how to handle it, I'm going to put some roundabouts. I'm going to put some things to slow you down. And roundabouts, definitely, they slow us down, don't they? And there's some. There was a lady over in Carmel last year. I was reading an article about, she was like, I think she was in her mid-70s. And she got in a roundabout. She got stuck. And she kept going around and around and around. And I guess it was like for 30 or 45. She could not get herself out of the roundabout. And they had to call the police out to help her get out of the roundabout. I hope there's nobody that goes that direction either. This isn't about just staying, well, God didn't do it, so I'm just going to stay. They that wait on the Lord, we're going to talk about that. But most times, the waiting is so that you can experience what God has for you. That there is a dynamic in our impatience, and it's a natural thing because everything in our life says instant, doesn't it? Instantly, if you want a coffee, you can put a cake up. You don't even have to wait for the water and the slow drip. We don't have time. It's a cake up in it, or it's through a Starbucks. It's instantly. If you want to heat up your food, what do? You don't put it in the oven very often. You put it in a microwave, hit it. If you want information, it's not like back in the day, way before the day, when it was Pony Express or a telegraph. It's instant. We expect that text to be answered when? Within 5 seconds after it's sent? Anybody would like to wait 5 days for somebody to answer your text? You want instant in so much of our life, and that bleeds over into our Christian walk. We want God to do things right now. It is not new. In fact, it's very old. In fact, it makes it so important that in Genesis, the place of beginnings, not just the beginning of earth, but the beginning of so many first principles, you find a very powerful example of the inability to wait, of impatience that impacts. Well, it was so big that it was so large that his inability to wait still impacts us today. And it was a powerful man. It wasn't a cheap Christian. It wasn't somebody it was Abram. It was Abram, of all people, the father of faith, has created the chaos that we live in today because of his impatience. And it's amazing. I don't think it wasn't intentional. He just did not understand how important it is to wait on God, to allow God to unfold his plans, to not intervene, not overstep your boundaries, not to create and cause it, but to say, God, if you have spoken something, I have a confidence that I don't have to create it. I don't have to manipulate it. God, you have the ability to do it. And it's not a God problem. It's our problem that says, I just can't wait. And it came in that moment when God came to Abram and said, I'm going to give you and Sarah a son. And they were excited, but they said, hey, this cannot be. Abraham has been told, your seed is going to be as the stars. You get out in the where it's dark and you see stars, and it's not like they're, it is as the sands of the sea. They're just billions of stars. We've been out west and seen those. That's what God says of Abram. But Abram has a problem. Sarah or he, one of them, they cannot have children. We have people in this church that have had that issue or have that problem. They've not been able to have children. So Abram doesn't have medicine. They don't have anything. And so they decide, we can't wait on God's time. We got to help him. Does anybody else ever try to help God? I'm here to tell you, God don't need any help. If he's created the stars, the ocean, the moons, the skies, the mountains, the rivers, the lakes, the fish, the birds, I think he can handle your situation. But somehow Abram lost focus that God could step in at any moment. God had spoke a word. What you have to have confidence is not in your ability, but in God's spoken word. And there is a thing called a Bible that is his spoken word. And if you'll get into his spoken word, he will tell you. Abram has a word. Is there anybody that would just love to have the have a word besides you? Most of us want another word besides the word he's given us. I would like that audible voice sometimes. I don't think we're going to get many of those. But I do have a word that tells me things, that tells me promises, that tells me what he will do. And Abram gets this word, and it doesn't happen in his timing. It doesn't happen in the 75 seconds. And he runs the stoplight. They come up with a wonderfully creative idea. Hey, let's invite somebody else into our marriage. You ever thought of it in that terms? Let's invite somebody else into our marriage. Anybody gonna sign up for that one? I don't think that's the best thing to happen. And somehow, two brilliant people, the father of faith, goes, yeah, great idea. And so it's Sarah that goes, I'll even pick for you. This is going downhill fast. Where was the ability? Where was somebody? Where was a friend? Where was the preacher? Where was somebody going, wait, this is not a good, wait, this... No, don't you understand? They never get it. And so they create Ishmael, this child from another woman. And the reason that we deal with the issues of the Muslims and the hatred of Israel all goes back. It's hard to imagine that one act of impatience could impact a world for over 4,000 years. But here we sit. I'm here to speak to somebody that is thinking about hastening a choice, about jumping ahead or helping God. Wait. It's just 75 seconds. It seems like a long time, but 10 years versus what we're experience because of his is not a long wait. And sometimes it may seem like God has put you on a string and put you in a place where you're waiting forever. Have confidence in what God has said. Have confidence in God's word. He will accomplish that he's spoken. It is the same story in 1 Samuel chapter 13. It's a significant moment for Saul. And I want you to understand, these are not small people. So for people that have trouble waiting, I want you to know that you're in good company. Abraham's a great man. He is the man of faith, but he struggled. So all of that speaks to me that all of us struggle. There's an anointed man in 1 Samuel 13. His name is Saul. He was a humble man and a man that God said, this is who I want to be king over. If you're going to have a king, this is the king that I want you to have. And things are going well, but then there is a battle, because there's going, even if you're anointed, even if you're chosen, even if you're doing the right things, you got to know stuff is going to come at you. Life is just life. Whether you're the king of Israel, whether you're the anointed one that God, you're still going to get stuff. And Saul is getting stuff coming at him, and the battles that he's getting, armies are beginning to come up against him. And a word comes to Samuel saying, hey, I know you want to go into battle. I know you're weary of this, but I need you to wait. Don't go until there's a sacrifice, and don't let there be a sacrifice until I get there. And in that time between the spoken word and when Samuel shows up, it's just 7 days. It's just 75 seconds. It's really not that long in the context of his whole life. It's not long in context of his anointing and what God's purpose is for him. It's not long in relationship to the battle, because the battle's going to be won quickly. It's just having to wait. And so, as he's waiting, things begin to unravel. And that's when we get worried. That's when we get anxiety. That's when the stress comes. And people started fragmenting away. They started breaking away from his arm. He was having desertion, and the armies, everything is pressing in heavy. And the last thing you want to do when it gets bad is to say, no, just wait. Just hold on. Saul is looking at the watch, the sundial, and he said 7 days. And if he doesn't make it, just when I say, I'm going to have to step in. And isn't it like us to put a timeline on God, to put a timeline on the events? And then when God doesn't do it in that timeline, we get discouraged. We say, okay, God's not working, so I'm just going to step in. Wait 75 seconds. And it feels like it's just 75 seconds in this text in 1 Samuel 13, that as soon as it's that moment of time and he wants to gun it and he wants to get on with the green light, that he takes the sacrifice, he steps into the position that he was not called, and he begins to cut, and he builds the fire and lays the sacrifice. The meat's still burning. It's just still fresh. And in walks Samuel. Saul, what are you doing? You stepped out of your position. You were anointed. You're king, but you're not priest. You cannot do the godly. You cannot do the supernatural. It's only God that can do this. It's only you've got to follow. And his inability to waste cost him the kingdom, cost him a great, it wasn't, it, Saul's initial sin was not something great. It wasn't an immoral affair. It wasn't a great lie. It wasn't drunkenness. It was his initial sin that started his downfall was more of a confidence in himself than the confidence in God's word. I'm here to speak. You've got to have confidence in God's word. And even when he delays, I still have to wait. He rips the cloak of Samuel. And it's that moment that God says, not only did my cloak get ripped, Samuel's cloak get ripped, but the kingdom has been ripped away. Why? It seems so small. But it was the inability to wait. It is Matthew chapter 25. That we get first of three great principles, Matthew 25. It is the bridegroom that tarries, and there are 10 virgins who are waiting. And we know the story well. There were 5 that had oil and were prepared, and there were 5 that were not prepared for what? A delay. They were not prepared to wait. And may I tell you, you may be in search of the bridegroom. You may be in search of things that God wants to work and do in your life, but you've got to be prepared that part of God's process often involves delay. I don't know why the bridegroom was delayed. I don't know why he didn't show up on time, but you've got to have in your game plan, in your life plan, the understanding that sometimes God doesn't show up and I have to have enough anointing. I've got to have enough devotion. I've got to have enough to say, okay, if he doesn't show up, I still got oil. When God doesn't show up, I have to understand that delays do come, and I have to anticipate. In my spiritual life, I have to anticipate delays. I've got to make sure. Why do I pray? Why do I have my time? It's not just a ritual. It's not just part of, because I understand that sometimes it doesn't happen in my dynamics. It doesn't, and so I have to anticipate that delay, and I got to keep myself full of oil, because there's sometimes God just doesn't show up when I want him to. Number two, the second thing I understand is from 2 Kings chapter 2, it is and it's the story of Elijah and Elisha. You have to understand this. Principle number two of waiting is this. Is sometimes the delays are intentional. Sometimes God doesn't move because he wants to see your dedication. He wants to see your passion. He wants to see your hunger, to see if you've got what it takes to push through those times of, well, those 75 seconds. And as Elijah calls Elisha and throws the mantle on his back, they begin their journey, and it's not an instant journey like we hope sometimes that it is. There's stops at Bethel and Gilgal and at Jordan, and every time the prophet Elijah says to Elijah, would you like to stay here? And Elisha says, no, master, I'm not staying. I know it's a delay, and I know there's an opportunity here to camp out here at, I've got a higher calling, and even though I'm having to wait, I'm still going with you. It happens at Gilgal, and then at Bethel, he comes again. Hey, would you like to stay here? This is nice. There's contentment here. You could just stay here. He says, no, I'm not settling for this. I'm going to wait for what you promised, that there was a mantle, that you have a portion, and I'm getting a double portion. And that double portion sometimes means I've got to wait. Even so, this was an average opportunity. This is a good opportunity. Jordan might be a better opportunity, but I want the great opportunity. I want what God has. I want the best that God has. I don't want to settle for just a partial blessing. I want the double anointing. Is there anybody in this room that would love to have a double anointing of God's presence and power? I would love to be a part of a generation that got the double portion of that. That what we have seen in the past, we've only seen half. There's a double blessing that's coming. There's a double move of God's Spirit coming. That's what I'm hungry for. But instead, sometimes I mean I have to wait. It also means this. What I think is very important that Elisha did is understanding I might have to wait, but there's no options. I'm not going back to what was. You got to burn some things that when it's convenient to go back to them, you don't have the option to go back to. So as soon as the word of the Lord, the mantle is laid across his back, Elisha burns the plow and cooks the cow. So every time a wait comes, and it's like, well, if I wait, I could go back. He's standing there. Well, I can't stay here because my plow is broken down and my cows are burned. And another opportunity, well, my cows are burned and my plows are gone. And what is that? That means I will wait until I get what I have been told I will receive. And if you will wait, there will be a moment of time when God will allow his mantle to fall on you. God's going to allow his mantle to fall on this church. And we're going to see the glory of the Lord. But wait is so critical. Then our final text, where we started today. Jesus. Glorified in body, nail prints in arms and feet, pierced brow. We can see it all. Man. Is there anybody here that whatever he said, you think, man, I could do that? I don't care how weak you may be. I just feel like, man, if I am with glorified Jesus and I have seen him go to the grave and I've seen him resurrected and he is talking and we've been having fish and chips and drinking Pepsi. It's been a good, he speaks this word and says, wait on the promise which I told you about. I'm down with that. There was nearly 500 people that heard that. Go wait on the promise. And wow, initial energy is incredible. It's like last week. Initial crowds at every church in America. But we're just 7 days out. And where'd they go? The energy, the passion, the fire that we felt last week. That he'll show up, that he's got this, the message. And already, you couldn't wait. Didn't have the stamina. And again, no fingers pointing. Because it's natural. From 500, and it was what, 75 seconds, wasn't it, that Jesus asked him to wait. He said, just go wait. But this was the challenge of this wait, like so many of our waits. There was no endpoint. And when there is no endpoint, attrition just begins to happen. But I promise you this, God will not make you wait beyond your ability to do so. And those 120 people that had the ability to wait experienced the greatest power, the greatest promise any person could experience. But 380, 75% of the people missed the moment because they couldn't wait. Isaiah 40:3, as I begin to come to a close this morning. My word to you this morning, Isaiah 40:31, you know it well. You can quote it. You don't know you can quote it. Yet those who wait on the Lord, why the wait? I think you get your answer in wait in this verse. Again, I don't know who this is for. Maybe it's for me. I know it is for me. I hope it's for you. The very first thing, a promise. What's the very first thing you need to know? If you learn to have patience, if you learn to wait, we'll gain what? New strength. Waiting, as difficult as it is, gives you the ability to have strength that you've never had before. You know why some of you cannot stand in the heat of battles? Because you've never had the ability, or rarely do you have the ability, to wait. People leave churches because they don't know how to wait. People leave God because they don't know how to wait. People leave marriages because they don't know how to wait. People lose relationships because they don't wait for the marriage day. And they live with skeletons and scars because they allow immorality. And the world says, don't wait, don't wait. Fulfill that desire now. And God, you can't go against the biblical. Wait! And what happens? You gain strength. And if I knew as an adversary that my opponent would gain strength, what would I do? I would, that every day that my opponent waited, if I challenged somebody to a game of one-on-one, or you challenged me, I'm gonna use Brendan, he's the ball player. Brendan, if you and I play, and we're playing to 24, it's 24-0, you win. Unless I just get lucky and you just back off and I happen to jack a three and it bounces around. But if Brendan knew that every day that I waited, I got quicker, I got bulkier, I definitely need bulk. And then I added some more quicks. And maybe I grew about 3 or 4 inches because I'm gaining strength. What would Brendan... He'd be called, hey, let's play that game now. Because he knows on Tuesday, I'm going to be faster. And he knows on Thursday, I'm going to be taller. And he knows on Friday, I'm going to be stronger. That's exactly what happens spiritually. When you start saying, God, I'm waiting on you, you start gaining new strength. So your adversary is after you every single day, going, let's surrender, give up now. Because every day you wait, you're becoming more of a giant. You're becoming stronger in faith. You're becoming bolder in your walk with God. Gain new strength when you wait. What else happens? Number two, you mount up with wings like eagles. Another version says you soar where eagles go. Where do eagles go? Do they fly in the trees? You find them ducking around in low waters looking for little minnows? You're not going to find a bird that goes higher than an eagle. And it gets up above everything. It sees every foe. It sees every ad. It gets perspective that you cannot get anywhere else. When it gets ready to dive down for that food, it's running 100. It's going to hit that water and nail that fish or that whatever it wants. It's going to, because it's flying from such a high perspective. And it can I tell you, when you wait on the Lord, you get a different perspective that you're not going to get. So number two, you get perspective when you, oh, if I had only waited, if I could have seen, talk to the 380 that weren't there that day. Oh, if I would have just waited. I didn't allow myself to soar up high enough to see the possibility. I could not imagine. Can I tell you, the adversary wants to keep you in a low position where you don't see. But when you learn to wait, you start getting higher. That's why I like to be around people of patience, because they start seeing things from a different, you start getting a heavenly view. And thirdly, you'll run and not get tired. I honestly would love to run a marathon. Don't fall out of your seat, Mary. I would. But I just get tired. I don't have the stamina, and I haven't built enough of that. I'm so proud of you, Mary. She pulled them out the other day. She just does that every once in a while. She has 6 marathons that she's ran, clankety clank. 6 half marathons. Excuse me. Still 13.2, and she's like, I got to get one more. She wants that perfect 7. And she runs. And I remember the time she did. She got where, you know, when she first started running, she'd run a mile, and she's like, I got tired. I run 100 yards and I'm tired. But then she would just keep running and keep running. And I remember when she was going over 10 miles running 3 times a week. Why? Was it easy? No. But she had the ability to wait. She understood, if I just keep running, I'm not seeing the goal. I'm not seeing the finish line. There are no great crowds. There's no trophies for the days that you just keep going. You just keep doing. When it doesn't make sense, when it's painful, it's difficult, but you just keep. But there comes a point, she tells me, and I will never, unless God like anoints me with oil and then somebody else like offers me 10,000, I will never know what this word is, but some of you know, it's called the runner's high. And it's a place where you get, she says, I'm disbelieving her. It may be stuff that she's just making up so that she can try to get me to go there. But she says, you just get to this point. You push past this line, and then it's not difficult anymore. Can I tell you, when you wait on the Lord, you're going to get to a place where you just don't get, nobody's going to tire you out. Nobody, it's not going to be hard to pray. But you've got to learn to wait. And the last, and do you notice something here? Because this is really the battle sometimes. You're going to gain new strength, but sometimes it's, look at the dimensions here. We're soaring, but then sometimes we're running. But look what the honesty of the author says. Sometimes I just have to walk. It's not always going to be eagles and mountain. It's not always going to be running. But when you wait on God, you'll walk with God. You'll walk with Him through every trial and difficulty. You'll walk through Him through death. You'll walk through Him through sickness. You'll walk through Him through heartache and pain. You'll walk through Him through difficulty. And when you don't understand what pastors do, you just learn to walk with God, and you do not get worried. You do not get anxious. God wants to take us to another dimension. Stand with me this morning. How many would love to have the ability to say, I'll wait? How many wants that ability today? God, give me the ability. It's not a natural ability necessarily, but it's something that God will give us. And I promise, if you'll pray, God, give me the strength to wait, He's gonna surround you. He's gonna help you. He's gonna strengthen you. Seconds. Just bow your head. God, you're working in somebody's heart right this moment.